Well, good afternoon, everyone. Whoa, this is the tech call. Good afternoon, everyone. There we go. Because we are all here to have a conversation, to continue a dialogue, to talk about ideas and issues of concern to everyone in this room. And to do that, we've all got to participate. So good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for that welcome. I want to thank the organizers of this conference for inviting me. It's really a pleasure and a privilege to be here today. And of course, I want to thank you for inviting me to this conversation with all of you, the conversation about how do we advance, how do we grow and protect one of our most essential human assets. And that, of course, is the information that we share with and about each other. This is primarily going to be a discussion about a number of issues, but security is, of course, first and foremost. And so this particular group of people, this industry lead group, this conference, you all started this conversation 25 years ago because you knew and you recognized that the issues that the gift of technology gives us present not only opportunity, but great challenge. And to overcome those challenges, we have to have bold thinking, we have to have close cooperation, but the main thing that we have to have for innovation to even exist is a conversation. So I thank you for spurring that conversation, for catalyzing those new ideas, and for forging the lasting partnerships that ensure that our capacity to develop technology is matched by our ability to protect it. Because of course, as we all know, as long as humans have shared information with one another, whether across a fence or across an ocean, other humans have sought to block, to steal, to tamper with that data. But information and the technology that stores and transports it has never been more important to our society. And so the task of securing this information and the need for conversations about it has never been more urgent or more challenging. So let's talk, all right? Now today, we rely on digital technology for functions as routine as conversation, or watching movies, buying groceries, and also for functions as consequential as distributing electricity and directing our military. And in the years to come, it's clear that the use of technology is only going to grow and develop further. And this is a profoundly good thing. This is, in fact, a great thing. It's a revolutionary transformation that we're in the middle of, and I'm really happy to be here. I know that many of you in this room have been part of that revolution. But as with every gift that we develop, every benefit that comes from applying our thoughts and our creativity and creating these new avenues of communication, we also have new avenues for a variety of wrongdoers, from thieves, hackers, terrorists, violent extremists, state-sponsored actors, the list can and will go on. And these criminals also rely on virtual methods to inflict very real damage. And as several high-profile incidents have reminded us in recent years, and as we are learning just in the past few days of incidents in other countries, these online adversaries are posing significant threats, not just to personal privacy, but also to our economic property and to our national security. Now, I am tremendously proud to run the cabinet agency that is entrusted with the enforcement of America's laws, the protection of the American people, and the defense of American ideals. Department of Justice has a special responsibility to address these threats. We are working on a number of fronts to meet the law enforcement challenges of the 21st century. Now, we've used a host of tools, ranging from criminal prosecutions to sanctions to designations and diplomatic options as well. But many of you are familiar with the FBI's Cyber Division, which investigates and monitors digital intrusions and security risks around the clock. Now, each of the 56 field offices operates a cyber task force that helps bolster our resilience at the state and local levels. But the FBI also leads a 19-agency National Cyber Investigative Joint Task Force established by the administration in 2009. And its goal is to coordinate the government's response to online dangers. Each of the 93 U.S. attorneys from every state and territory also prosecute cyber crimes and interface with corporations and public assets on cybersecurity and preventing cyber intrusions. Our criminal division within DOJ recently formed a cybersecurity unit. This is staffed by experienced prosecutors who are steeped in the law and the policy and the practice of cybercrime prevention. And our National Security Division has created the nationwide NSCS network. And this is over 100 specially trained federal prosecutors in every jurisdiction who combat online threats to our national security. And our Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Explosives has created an Internet Investigations Center where federal agents and lawyers work together to counter illegal online firearms trafficking. This is a short list of a few of the ways that we're working to investigate and disrupt a wide range of cyber crimes and threats. Many of you in this room have called on us for help, as well as have you provided your services to us and your insights as we fight this challenge together. One thing that's also clear as we look at the emerging threat landscape is that, of course, this threat does not stop at our water's edge. It does not stop at our borders. It crosses borders, it transcends boundaries and countries. And what we're also focused on doing is working closely with our overseas partners to promote global cybersecurity. And one of our most invaluable allies in that effort is the European Cybercrime Center, EC3. You're familiar with EC3 as well, the European Union's Central Cybercrime Coordinating Body. Now, in November 2014, we joined with EC3 to launch Operation Animus, which shuttered a number of the so-called dark market websites. These websites, as you know, sell drugs, weapons, stolen credit card data, fake passports, and computer hacking tools. Just this past July 2015, we joined with EC3 to shut down the Dark Code Hacking Forum, the underground site where hackers bought and sold and traded malicious software, botnets, intrusion tools, as well as stolen personal information. Now, that operation was spearheaded by DOJ and EC3, but we weren't the only ones working on it. In fact, a coalition of 20 nations led to the takedown of Dark Code, and we arrested 70 members and associates around the world. And we continue to work with EC3 and other international organizations to root out the data thieves, the hackers, and the other malicious actors who seek to breach the secure space of the internet for their own destructive purposes. Now, all of us, DOJ and EC3, are struggling with the changes wrought by technology in this landscape, but this collaboration has yielded real results. It has protected real people, it has protected real data, and it has made many corporations on both sides of the Atlantic more secure. And these types of collaborations will continue. Now, beyond our focus on specific cases, we also are looking into the world of international criminal justice processes. Because as we become more globalized, not just in terms of law enforcement, but in terms of doing business overseas, long a factor for successful U.S. companies, the digital age has raised digital challenges. So what we have been doing is working with our allies to streamline the way that we and our allies can access electronic evidence across borders. As many of you know, the challenges are not necessarily technical in this regard, but are cultural and often legal. Now, when it comes to the world of criminal investigations, however, we have seen situations where particularly our American companies have faced vulnerabilities in dealing with a conflict of law issues. When our allies investigate criminal activities abroad, they increasingly require access to electronic evidence from American companies, often stored here. And these are companies that are providing internet communication services to citizens and residents of other countries, as of course all companies do. Our companies often face conflicting and competing legal obligations when those governments require them to disclose electronic information that U.S. law prevents them from disclosing. They're caught literally in a bind there. But in addition to harming our allies' efforts to investigate terrorism and other serious crimes, this has been a hardship for our companies. Either they comply with a foreign order and risk a violation of American law, or they refuse to comply and they risk a violation of foreign law, where they also do business. And we've given a great deal of thought to this issue. How can we alleviate these burdens? How can we alleviate these burdens while we also advance public safety and protect privacy and civil liberties? And we have been aided immeasurably by the conversations, by the discussions that we have had with academics, with civil societies, and with all of you in the communications industry. And that is why today I am pleased to report that we have begun negotiations with the United Kingdom to establish a new framework that will permit UK authorities to access electronic communications directly from American companies where the investigation targets accounts not used by Americans or people in the United States. The classic situation. To qualify, the UK government would have to agree to a number of provisions that are designed to protect privacy and fundamental rights, and a UK order would have to comply with UK law. Now, this agreement that we're working on would release American companies from conflicting legal obligations in clearly and carefully defined circumstances. It would help one of our oldest allies perform high priority criminal investigations that keep its citizens safe, and many of which, in this age of transnational crime and terrorism, would also further American interest. But it would also provide reciprocal benefits for US government requests to UK companies, which could help American investigations in the years ahead. And if it proves successful, if we can establish this framework, which I believe that we can, it could be replicated with other countries. Now, this replication would occur if and only if their countries also adequately protected privacy and civil liberties. Now, you hope that this will also encourage other nations to improve their laws, to enhance privacy protections in order to obtain the benefits of this arrangement. Now, this new framework that I've described, although very beneficial to U.S. companies, would require congressional action in order to take effect. And we will continue the conversation that we've begun and that has been so helpful with communications companies, with civil society groups, and with academics as we move forward. But based on these conversations and based on the collaboration that we have had so far, which we enjoy with so many of you and your colleagues, I'm hopeful that we can take an important step forward that benefits security, commerce, international cooperation, and privacy. All of these can exist and do exist in the same world. All of these can be protected by the same people working together at the same time. Now, of course, I'm talking now about a partnership that we are entering into with another government, but we're not limited to government agencies. In addition to standing alongside our global counterparts, we are committed to working closely with the private sector. Indeed, some of our most fruitful collaborations and conversations have occurred with you. Over the last few years, we've used these partnerships and your advice to help protect information systems to address cyber threats. Many of you are familiar with our groundbreaking Core Flood operation, in which we were able to free hundreds of thousands of computers from criminal control with the help of private experts and additional network security companies. Many of you are familiar with our takedown of the botnet known as Game Over Zeus. In situations like this and so many others, we've consistently worked side by side with private sector security experts like all of you in this room, to halt these technologically sophisticated crimes and to bring the perpetrators to justice. And over the course of these conversations that we've been able to have over the years, we have created new channels for information sharing and cooperation with the private sector to help us detect, deter, and to disrupt cyber threats. Now, cases like the Sony intrusion, in which we publicly named for the first time the nation state responsible for a destructive attack on an American company, demonstrate the power of reporting these incidents and providing information to us. Our relationships, the Justice Department's relationships in this area, form an important part of our ability to do our best work. Now, there's just no doubt in my mind that America's technology sector represents one of the greatest repositories of ingenuity and innovation in human history. And those of us who are responsible for protecting the American people in a time of increasingly sophisticated threats would be remiss if we didn't seek your help, if we didn't seek the assistance of experts like the people who are here in this room. And that is why we have consistently reached out and collaborated with you and your companies in a number of ways, including through the FBI's InfraGuard partnership, the National Cyber Investigative Joint Task Forces, regular consultations with the private sector, and my own frequent meetings with industry leaders, where we try and work together to identify these emerging threats and, whenever possible, to devise productive solutions to pressing issues. And in fact, these conversations continue. Just last week, the Department of Justice hosted a group of experts from some of America's foremost tech companies for a discussion about how we can work together to effectively counter violent extremism. This is the problem of the day in our national security framework, as we have seen the national security threat morph and change from the large-scale orchestrated attacks of 9/11 and shortly thereafter to the rise of the homegrown extremists in the cases that we are seeing. We and American industry are working together to find ways to break that chain of connection from terrorist rant to the hearts and minds of those who are most vulnerable. This conversation followed a number of other gatherings that examine ways, our common goal, to deny criminals and terrorists the safe harbors that they seek in the recesses of the internet and the hidden corners of our networks. Now, of course, this conversation would not be complete without a discussion of our going dark issues. And as you know, this is a very real threat to law enforcement's mission to protect public safety and to ensure that criminals are caught and held accountable. It is the mission of the Department of Justice, and in fact, it's our obligation to victims and to the public, to all of you, whose safety we must protect, to ensure that we have done everything under the law to fully investigate terrorist attacks and criminal activity on American soil. And from all of my conversations, that's a goal that I know that we all share. I know from my conversations that neither our technology companies nor their leaders have any sympathy for the terrorists and criminals who target Americans. And the Department of Justice will never sacrifice the safety of the American people or the ideals that we all cherish and make us who we are. But as recent events have made clear, these stakes are not just theoretical. They bear directly on our public safety and our national liberty. And that is why the conversations, the discussions, the talks, the communications that we have, like this one, are so important, because they help us connect to protect America's infrastructure, American networks, American values, and American lives. And I want you all to know how much I appreciate your support in that endeavor. Whether you agree with everything we say or not, it has been a productive and a great collaboration. And I look forward to continuing a frank dialogue and a fruitful partnership with this industry in the months ahead. We won't always find ourselves on the same side of every issue. And I'm guessing that there's a few issues out there that we might disagree on, maybe. Because the challenges raised by modern technology are complex, and they're not going to get any simpler. But as we venture forward into the digital age, the questions that we're going to be grappling with are only going to become more difficult, more intricate, and more intertwined. But in order to surmount these obstacles that I know we all see, we don't have to be locked in perpetual and perfect agreement. We do not. But we do have to be engaged in open dialogue so that we can draw on each other's resources, so that we can hear each other's concerns, and so we can learn from each other's perspective. And that's how we have always solved problems in America. It's how we've spurred new ideas. It is how we have pushed technology forward. It's how we have found a way forward. And I am convinced that that's how we are going to continue to strengthen our defenses, to prevent damaging crimes, and to bring wrongdoers to justice. The problems that have been generated by the great gift of technology, like all of the issues in human history, will be solved, as always, by humans working together, talking to each other, communicating, sharing the ideas, and ultimately working together to find a solution. That goal, our relationship, our connection, our commitment together to protect the American people is certainly one of my top priorities as Attorney General. And I continue to rely on your vision and your commitment and your cooperation in the months ahead. So I want to thank you for having me in this conversation. I want to thank you for having the conversation at all. And I look forward to everything that we're going to talk about, everything that we're going to achieve, everything that we're going to do together. Because when you look at what we have accomplished so far, things that were impossible 2 years ago, 5 years ago, even 10 years ago, there's nothing we can't solve. I'm convinced of that. So thank you so much for having me. Thank you so much for the conversation, and I look forward to continuing it right over here. Thanks again.
Madam Attorney General, thank you so much for having me here today for this conversation on a very busy day for you, what's been a very busy couple of weeks. So I appreciate it.
Happy to be here. Thank you.
So on that note, you've had a lot going on recently with a little company called Apple. Why did you make coming to RSA a priority today?
Well, I was actually fortunate enough to have received this invitation some months ago, and we thought, gee, what could we do to make it interesting? No. Actually, no, I think it was just a confluence of time and events. But I think that the fact that this issue has arisen while you all are having this conference just shows how important these issues are, how timely they are, and how they can come up really without anyone predicting them. We live in such a digital age now that these issues have to be dealt with and have to be addressed. And so I think it's a great conversation to have.
You have less than a year left as Attorney General. What do you want to accomplish? What are your priorities?
So I have been looking at the landscape, obviously, since before I took this chair, and certainly now that I'm in it. We're focusing, obviously, on national security and terrorism. As I mentioned earlier, the threat has changed. It has morphed. But the fact that America remains a target has not. And we are, in fact, seeing new ways of targeting American interests here and overseas all the time. Protection of vulnerable people, particularly those who have been caught up in human trafficking, is a priority of mine. Working to improve the relationship between law enforcement and the communities we serve has been a long-standing priority of mine as U.S. Attorney and now as Attorney General. And also cybersecurity is one of my top priorities. When you think about the threats that we face to our intellectual property, to our infrastructure, as well as to the personal safety and identity of every American, these are huge issues.
The people in this audience are building these technologies. Given what is going on between Apple and the FBI, do you believe that technology is outpacing the law?
You know, I think that the law has a wonderful elastic quality to cover the issues that develop. And that's what those of us who work in the field try and do. We try and advance it in a way that keeps it current, keeps it relevant, and that as we have these discussions, applies it to the current legal issues. I think technology is a wonderful thing. The growth of technology, frankly, is the growth of this country, and I would do nothing to stop that. But they can coexist, and they do coexist all the time.
But technology is also making your job more difficult, especially in this particular case. What is the risk if Apple or any company built a device or a product that the government could not infiltrate?
You know, I think there's two risks. There's a very specific issue of a specific matter in which we find ourselves in now, where we know, well, we don't know what's on the particular device in issue in the case, but we know that devices are more and more the repository of all types of information, and they are so essential to investigating and solving serious crimes. Having the inability to actually obtain evidence that could save lives is a real risk. And the other issue that we have to face is, how are we going to decide these issues? And essentially, how are we going to determine the scope of what law enforcement can and can't do? And those are other risks that I think are have to be part of the national discussion.
Encryption is supposed to make us safer. By asking Apple to unlock this phone or circumvent encryption, isn't that making us less safe?
Well,
would that be making us?
I think encryption does make us safer. I think that certainly I know that I support encryption and have been someone who's very, very focused on that. I think it does make us safer, but I think we can have both. And in fact, up until recently, Apple maintained the ability to provide information to the government without any loss of safety or security of the data that they stored on their devices. But I think one risk we run is making this all about Apple, when in reality it's about all of us. And it's about how all of technology, how all of commerce manages and protects our data. And the reality is, American industry is very good at encryption and using every method that we have to protect our information while also maintaining the ability to use that information for security purposes, for marketing purposes, and also to be responsive to court orders. It happens all the time, every day of the week, all across America. This is a very different decision by Apple to not participate in that national directive.
This is about one phone, the government has said, but there are 12 other cases involving 14 other phones. And I wonder, when you ask for Apple and the FBI to find a common ground, where is that middle ground? Give me some specifics on a middle ground that is not a slippery slope.
You know, I will tell you that I always think, for me, the middle ground is to devolve to what the law requires. You know, this is not about me telling Apple to do something. You know, I don't get to do that. I have to go to court and ask for permission to go into anything, whether it's a device, whether it's a box of documents in someone's house. And if there were a box of documents in someone's house that I could show a court may have evidence of a crime, and the lock on the door was such that I needed help to get in, and I needed someone to help me essentially so that I could try and get in without those documents self-destructing, that's what we're asking Apple to do. Don't run in and get it for us. Don't take that risk. Don't pull them out yourself. But in this instance, do what you did for years until about a year ago and essentially help us with this particular matter.
But Apple is saying if they make a key for this one particular door, they're making a key to all of our doors and we're all at risk, hundreds of millions of people.
You know, I think that, again, I think that Apple's a great company. All of our tech companies are fantastic and they do an excellent job of protecting encrypted data, unencrypted data, our most private information that we've entrusted them to, while also maintaining the ability to comply with court orders and also to use that data for their own purposes. This has been going on for years, and we have not had the parade of horribles that Apple is now asserting. You know, what we're asking them to do is to help us with this one particular device,
but it's
not to give
just
it to us, but not to give the technology to us. They could keep it, they could destroy it, they could essentially be done with it, mm-hmm. and it would let us try and get into the phone. We don't even want them to be the ones to get into it.
Right. It's not just this particular phone, though. There are other phones that across the country the government wants access to, and in Brooklyn just yesterday, a judge said that Apple didn't have to do that when it came to a drug dealer. Does that undermine your argument here?
You know, we did receive that decision yesterday, obviously disappointed in it. We'll be resubmitting it to the court with our views on that. I would note that that was a case in which Apple had actually promised to help us. It's an older version of the phone, doesn't involve encryption at all, one of the many cases in which they and other companies have provided assistance over the years, and their position didn't change until the judge's request for their opinion became public. So I think that it's clear that that's an issue where it doesn't even involve encryption. It's, will you do what you've always done, which is, as every American citizen and company do, comply with the law and respond to a request for the government from assistance. I think your point about other phones being involved shows how ubiquitous the phone as a collection of information is. This is where data does reside. And that's why, certainly in my view, and the view that I hold for the Department of Justice, our ability to go into devices has to be limited, has to be focused, has to be specific to what we need to find. Now, this is not a request to rummage around and hope that we find something. As with everything, when we go into a home and search it, or an office and search it, that request has to be, and should always be, limited to the specific issues that we think may be there. And when it comes to electronic data, whether it's on a phone or a computer, which we handle all the time, we want to set up safeguards so that we don't go further than that. That's our obligation, and I'm committed to making sure that that's how we handle ourselves in the law enforcement area. But I do think that there are other obligations as well, in the sense that, you know, we're all here in this great country, participating in this great democracy. And with the ability to live in this wonderful country and create these beautiful things come responsibilities. Part of the social compact that we've all agreed to is that we're going to work under this framework of laws. Again, not what I say. You know, I don't get to call up Apple and say, I'd like you to, you know, give me something. It has to be approved by a neutral third party, a judge, who says, okay, under the existing law, this is what you can get, and no further.
So speaking of law, Apple says that this request violates not just their First Amendment rights, but their Fifth Amendment rights. Why don't you buy that argument?
Well, you know, the Fifth Amendment protects people from self-incrimination. And anyone who's watched episodes of Law and Order, you know the drill. You know, you've got the right to remain silent. If you give up that right, anything you say can and will be used against you. You know, Apple's not a target in this matter. We're not alleging that they have done anything wrong. If we were, they would certainly have rights, and we wouldn't actually, under current law, not be allowed to ask them to give us evidence that could harm them or incriminate them. They're a third party in this. You know, I think it's important to note that the customer in this, and I know that Apple's customers are very important to it, as they should be, the customer has asked for their help. Mm-hmm. The customer has said, help me obtain access to this password so the government can then see what information is on this phone. So they're a third party in this, and so there's no self-incrimination issues involved.
What about the First Amendment, right?
You know, there's an issue.
Speech?
I think that that's a very important topic for discussion. I think that's a very important topic for discussion because it has ramifications far beyond this case as to whether or not someone should write code to help it comply with the legal process, as most Americans have agreed to do, but as to whether or not it has commercial aspects compared with free speech aspects as well. I mean, one question would be, you know, what is the intersection of commercial speech and free speech when you're talking about code? Those are fascinating issues, but they aren't the issues that drive this case. And frankly, they aren't the issues that are going to drive how we in law enforcement work with the tech industry to resolve all of these issues. We're relying upon time-tested, time-honored values of law, values of equity there. And frankly, our obligations to protect the American people.
You've talked about the going dark problem, the inability to track terrorists when their communications are encrypted. We are living in a world where there is more data and information out there than ever. So why focus on this little bit of information that you don't have when you have more information than ever before?
You know, I get that response a lot from people who say we live in an age of information, everyone out there has a cell phone, there's all this data out there. And then when I say to them, so what of those data sets are responsive to law enforcement's needs to find out what a terrorist is planning to blow up next? There's not really a response to that. And I'm not saying that the average citizen should be an FBI agent and should know the answer to that question. But what I am saying is that that question is something that highlights the fact that all this information out there is not the responsive information that focuses on individuals who are trying to harm Americans and our interests. Some of it is. But if you are saying, if we want to decide as a society that what we want to do is to say to all of our law enforcement agencies, you know what, we're not going to let you investigate anymore. You're going to have to wait until somebody happens to come by with a cell phone and record something, and that's the only way you're going to gather data. We can say that as a country and a community, but we have to be very clear that that's what we're saying and of the ramifications thereof. And I don't think that's what the American people really want law enforcement to do. And they want us to do what we have always done, which is investigate crimes. They want us to do it within the law, and that's what they should expect. They want us to do it in appropriate ways, in appropriate measures, and they want us to essentially go to court and get orders so that we can, in limited situations, gather information.
Now, Tim Cook has said repeatedly that it's not going to be a limited situation. If this key was made, it's like cancer for iPhones. How do you respond to that analogy?
Well, I don't think that the older versions of iPhones had cancer. I think they were great. I think they worked.
But should we go back to iOS 7 then?
I don't think you have to go back to it. But I think what I find interesting about that argument, and again, I think Tim's a great guy. He's a great Southerner, as am I. And it's a great company. I just am curious as to why their view might be, you know what, we're going to innovate, we're going to create, we're going to move forward, but in this one area, we're done. I just find that surprising, and I'm not sure that that's really the best response to this issue.
So then from a technical perspective, do you buy the argument that there's no other technical way to do this? There's no other technical way to get into this phone other than to build this software.
You know, I think that's what they're looking at now, but I think that there are always ways to look at these issues that we have found to be very productive in talks that we've had with Apple and other companies. And I'm just, again, surprised that the choice would be, we're not even going to think about this anymore. We're done thinking on this issue. That's just not what I expect from one of our great American companies.
You think they can do more from a technical perspective?
Well, they can do this. They can do what's been asked of them. They've made the choice that it's not, you know, what they think is the appropriate thing to do. And again, I respect their positions. I respect Tim Cook a great deal. And his views will be heard in court, and they'll be decided in court. But I think we have to decide also as a country, in this conversation, do we let one company, no matter how great the company, no matter how beautiful their devices, do we let one company decide this issue for all of us? Do we let one company say, this is how investigations are going to be conducted and no other way? We don't do that in any other area.
On that note, I was speaking with the head of Android at Google, and I said, what if this was an Android phone and not an iPhone? And I wonder, do law enforcement agencies have Android phones that they cannot unlock? Or is there a fundamental difference between Apple and Android when it comes to encryption?
Well, what I'll say about that is that this case presents a specific issue with Apple now. And I think other companies, again, are going to look at it to see how they want to respond. But we have always found our tech companies, and by the way, I put Apple in that category as being helpful, cooperative in so many areas. So I don't want to call any one company out or highlight an issue with them, because by and large, really, our cooperation and collaboration with them has been very, very positive. And as I said, I put Apple in that category also. They do great work with us in the discussion on how do we counter violent extremism, for example. But we do have a disagreement in this fundamental area.
So there's a question of the implications that this could set for other governments. If Apple does this for the United States government, does that give license for the Chinese government and the Russian government to make the same requests? Doesn't that put us more at risk and undermine the competitiveness of our own company?
You know, again, I think that the issue that we are facing now is how do we, as an American law enforcement agency, fully investigate the worst terrorist attack on American soil since 9/11? Those issues are very important, and they should be part of the discussion. Those issues meaning, how do we also interact with other countries? As I noted in my comments, the international world is becoming so much more a part of what American business has to think about also. And I think we can have those discussions and we can talk about ways to manage those problems also. I would note, however, that it didn't seem to be an issue 14 months ago when Apple would have been able to respond to the government's request, and the same situations existed throughout the world. So I think that we can have both. We can have strong encryption. We can have great devices that protect our data and our privacy, which everyone wants and needs. But we can also have the ability to conduct law enforcement investigations in the way in which we always have, which is with the assistance of the courts in a limited, focused way.
Now, today you're announcing that the US and the UK have begun negotiations that will allow the British government to subpoena US companies for data relevant to investigations in the United Kingdom. How is that beneficial to America?
Well, they already do subpoena US companies. And by the way, this would be US companies who have a presence in the UK and therefore would be subject to UK law. So that if they, are operating there, they would receive it there and they would be subject to penalties if they don't comply. But because the data is often stored here, American law basically now says to US tech companies, you can't send that data overseas, even in response to a law enforcement request. So this has put American industry in a bind. They're doing business in the UK. They could be subject to penalties for not complying, but they could be subject to penalties here if they do comply. And these are companies who are saying, look, we're not trying to stand in the way of law enforcement. We understand the important interests here. And we've all sat down and had this discussion about what can we do here. The proposal would simply allow a UK company to subpoena an American tech company for data held here on their UK citizens. This is not about accessing data on American citizens. And in fact, it would not cover activity within the US. So we're talking about a crime committed in Great Britain against a Great Britain citizen, and they want to get information to help solve it. In those circumstances, if the UK framework of laws is such that it would protect the privacy of even that data, we would work out an agreement whereby the companies could comply and not be in violation of US law. This would require congressional action. But we're hopeful that we can make that case before Congress as well, because it would benefit American companies who have found themselves facing this conflict, wanting to cooperate. Obviously, they have a court order, but obviously not wanting to put themselves in legal jeopardy.
A company might say, why is it our responsibility to police, locally or internationally? Isn't that the government's job?
Well, I think the government relies upon the cooperation of citizens and companies as we carry out all of our functions, whether it's law enforcement, whether it's administrative, whether it's regulatory. I mean, the reality is we are all in this together. The government's job should be the protection of its citizens. I certainly view my job as Attorney General and my role within the Department of Justice as the protection of the American people. And that requires cooperation. So we have this system of laws, both here and in other countries. And what we have said as a society are that if we're operating in that framework of laws, people can safely comply with them, provide information, and not themselves generate a legal problem.
Now, as I understand it, the government has been, and you've been part of these conversations for a long time now, trying to rebuild the bridges between Washington and Silicon Valley, especially in light of Edward Snowden, and that the government was trying to work out a long-term agreement with U.S. tech companies around encryption specifically, and that those talks had made progress until the Apple situation blew up. How much progress has been made? Does it feel that any progress has been undone?
I tell you, I always feel like there's progress if people will sit down and talk to me. I think that when you can have those conversations, you will always be able to move forward and you will always be able to find a solution. The solutions that we're talking about, though, at least in the law enforcement arena, are very case specific. Mm-hmm. And that's why we also have to have the broader, you know, nationwide discussion as well about how do we want to decide these issues and who decides these issues. So what I found is in my discussions with tech companies, again, as I noted in my speeches, these are not individuals or people who are supporting criminal activity or terrorism. And so I regret sometimes when I listen to the tone outside, you know, in the debates about how, well, you know, aren't they trying to protect terrorists? That's not what people are trying to do. And I don't view it that way. You know, people have very sincerely, strongly held beliefs. We have sincere, strong held obligations, and we're all talking together about how do we ensure that we can do both. So I think that, and whenever there's what's called sort of a flashpoint incident, if this case might be considered one, it might be. But the benefit is we're all talking about this issue. And I think my hope is always that after we talk at each other, we'll talk with each other and really focus on these issues.
So give us some specifics about what you, ways that Washington and Silicon Valley can work together.
You know, one of the really most successful ways in which I think we're starting to work together, and I think it's one in which Silicon Valley is uniquely equipped to provide assistance in a much better way than government, is again, when we look at the use of technology by criminals, particularly terrorist activity, how do we handle that? Now, we know that a number of communications companies already have terms of service that prohibit certain types of inflammatory materials, you know, particularly terrorist activities, the videos, beheading videos, for example. And under their own terms, what they've decided is in terms of their being responsible corporate citizens, they do not promulgate that, and so they'll take it down. And that's something that I think is a corporate decision and I think has been a positive one. But as we also look at these issues, we look at a situation, particularly here in the U.S., where the nature of the threat has shifted to the homegrown extremist. These are people from all walks of life. It's not what is often portrayed in the media as there's one recognizable type of person, they're from a particular place, they look a particular way. No, what we are seeing are individuals who, for a variety of reasons, come to violent extremism from a source, a place of vulnerability, a place of disaffection, and they absorb this rhetoric, often online, and they then go out and commit terrible activities. So how do we, while we also protect the First Amendment and protect freedom of expression, how do we give these individuals something else to consider? Mm-hmm. How do we give them something else to think about? How do we give them the tools to evaluate what they're seeing online? This is something that obviously is of great interest to us, but I think is frankly of great interest to many companies who create wonderful content in other areas all the time, and it's been an area that has great promise, and we greatly appreciate their contribution to this field.
So we have an audience filled with people focused on cybersecurity. How will your policies affect them?
Our policies of collaboration and cooperation have already affected people, hopefully, I think, in a positive way, in that we are looking to provide information about cyber threats to the industry more quickly every day. I think if you compare the information we were able to push out for 2 years ago, a year ago, and now, what I hope is that you will see is that you get information from us about what we see and what we learn faster than before. That's how we're trying to help you. We also are working together to identify the people behind attacks, cyber intrusions, and sharing that information as well. One of the benefits that we had most recently is congressional activity. Yes, believe it or not, congressional activity that will help. That essentially says that if private companies do report intrusions and do provide information to the government about certain types of cyber intrusions, it limits their liability in those areas as well, because we often had situations where companies would want to give us information but were concerned about the attendant civil liability there that we felt should not have been a factor because they're trying essentially to protect everyone. So there's a host of ways in which we hope that we're helping industry. We are always looking for the tech industry to tell us what they need to see us do better, faster, more efficiently.
But what do you want them to help you with, the people in this audience, have the capability of building technology that can make your job easier, but also more difficult. So, parting words for the people that are making the technology that, you know, some people have said is going beyond the law.
You know, I don't know if that's the intent of people as they build it. I view it as this is one of the greatest parts of the American economy. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that I'm most proud of as an American is our tech industry and what we have been able to do. And so my only parting words would be continue to innovate, continue to create, continue to collaborate and think and design. But as you do, continue to have the conversations about all of the issues that come about with technology. None of us really have the luxury of living in an isolated world anymore. I know that this group knows that. I know this group doesn't live there. But the connections that you are forging with your technology and devices and systems are also important to think about as we think about the connections to the obligations that we all have for safety and security. So my parting words are continue to create, continue to innovate, and continue to talk and work with us, because we very much want to talk and work with you.
Attorney General Loretta Lynch, thank you so much.
Thank you.